I'm at NIAS, and for the last 10 years or more, I've been looking at the questions of women in science, moved on to looking at questions of women and science. And I'll just walk you through some of the questions that I have been sort of investigating and perhaps share what's the kind of framework that I have used in terms of looking at these questions. Now, before I get on to that, let me at least use this opportunity to thank the organizers who have asked me to come here. I've spent a day or so with this group. I think it's a very converted group. It looks like as if I'm talking to all women rather than women and men. So seriously, a large number of things that I'm going to say is something that may be familiar to y'all, but perhaps I'll try and walk y'all through the nuances of the research that I've been undertaking for the last decade. Now, before I go on to my presentation, let me wish each one of you a happy Women's Day. And I think today, let us use this opportunity to celebrate the success of women, and more importantly, try and see what seems to be the persisting challenges and be able to sort of analyze it and find ways in which we could sort of address those challenges which seem to be persistent despite the kind of efforts that have been done to address the challenges. The presentation would have, I'll go through the broad research question that guides the work that I've been doing. I'll look at some statistics. I have problems with the statistics, and I'll tell you all why. And then perhaps look at the field insights, which may be a little more interesting, that will sort of raise some of the questions that I want to sort of discuss today. Now, when you look at questions of gender equity broadly, I think it's important for us to evaluate women's professional success when compared to men's. Why are we using men and women together? I think one of the things that I like about this conference is y'all are addressing people who are much younger, starting their careers. So I think the impact of looking at questions of this would be long lasting, because at least for the next 3 decades y'all are here. And also important to see both men and women in the room, because I think when you're talking of these questions to only women, it really will not make an impact. So it is important to look at the professional success, look at men and women, and also broadly look at numbers, the educational levels, gender, and the stereotypes, which is extremely important. In this context, it is also equally critical to look at the professional outcomes vis-a-vis the familial outcomes. Here, we are visiting questions of family, society, socialization, attitudes, and gender roles. And next, you move to the question of the pipeline metaphor. Try to trace the journey of scientists as an undergraduate to professorship, and I'd like to tell you why this is more important for Indian women in science when compared to women in science in the West, because I think the problem we have are not the same problems that you have with women in science in the West. It is not difficult for us to see that their representation of women in science is increasing at all levels of education. The problem is, where are they going after acquiring their highest level of training is a problem. And in this entire thing, I think the focus needs to shift from not necessarily looking only at reasons of why women are not there, but more importantly, it is critical for us to look at questions of who are the women who have survived the system, how have they survived the system, and it's important to understand their story. And as we understand their story over the years of research, I have always tried to use disaggregated data so that the identity of the women scientists is not known. But increasingly now, I'm convinced that the potential of the story is lost when you're using disaggregated data, because you don't understand it within the context in which the data is presented. And this is the challenge currently I'm undergoing in terms of the research, and I'll talk more about it. Now, statistics, you look at the percentage enrollment of girls from 1950 to 2011. We are doing pretty well with respect to science. It is increasing. And engineering is giving us some problems, but I think by and large, you find that with respect to science, it's increasing. Medicine, by and large, has had a large number of women, and so I think the problems within the field of medical sciences is very different from the problems in the fields of physics or engineering, which has always had a lesser number of women in science. I just tried to put the data in terms of the actual numbers of women who are enrolled in PhDs, and I don't think this is the best data, but this is the highest data that you have, and I've constantly been arguing with the department that you need to give us data of women and men who have completed their PhDs. It is not very hard, because today all students, before they are awarded their degree, need to actually upload their thesis. So it's only a matter of a very small decision at the national level for you to be able to get the data of people who have completed their PhDs. A similar thing can be done with postdocs, because I think that gives you the actual number of people who are trained within the country. All countries have it. I can't understand what's the problem for India to put their numbers in place and give it to us on a real-time basis and make it available in the public domain so that we don't have to chase offices to get the numbers, and each time you chase offices, each office will give you numbers that are very different. And these numbers are pulled together when questions are raised in the parliament, and I think that's not the way how we need to do in terms of getting our numbers in place. Even with respect to the data that's happened with respect to AYUSH, it was the study that we had done in terms of looking at trends of PhD, where we tried to put a 10-year data in place and show how important it is to understand the distribution of men and women across disciplines and across regions. That gives you very clear insights in terms of policy interventions. It was after that they put this data in place, and now it is up and ready, and you have the data almost on a real-time basis. So if you look at the number of women students for PhD who are enrolled, science is still very high. And I think the question I keep asking is, why is the enrollment in science very high, PhDs? And one of the possible responses is, you have science being funded largely in the country when you compare it with social sciences. The funding is definitely, there's an imbalance. There is also a notion that the development and progress of a country can be, what do you say, can be achieved by only promoting science. And I think it's very important that you need to understand science, technology, and the other disciplines need to grow together. One hypothesis I have is in terms of why science in India, when you're competing with different countries, why is science in India not able to compete? I'm not saying they're not doing good science. I will not make that statement in this room. But I'm saying that the edge that the Western universities have with respect to Indian science is sciences are placed within universities where other domains of knowledge also grow along with science. It makes a huge difference. Today, when you're talking of interdisciplinarity, which you think is extremely important, I think the notion that you can move from biology to physics or move from chemistry to biology is at best you all can see, but I think knowledge domains move beyond the contours of sciences. More importantly, I think real problems in this world do not have disciplinary boundaries. And every time you choose a problem with a disciplinary boundary, claim to do interdisciplinary research by extending the boundary, and if both the disciplines or multiple disciplines that come into understanding the problem are not at equal on par with each other, then in terms of methods or the questions you ask, you definitely have a bias of the discipline that calls the question and invites the other disciplines. And I think it's very important that this pattern needs to be broken. Now, if you look at women in STEM, undergraduate, postgraduate, and at the PhD level, we are fairly good in terms of the representation. It is not very difficult. It's about close to about 40%. In fact, when you're looking at the data of women in the STEM discipline, I was just trying to get one of my teammates to put the data together. And very often when you look at the data, you always look at the data in terms of what is the percentage of women who do STEM disciplines vis-a-vis the total women. And I say that's the wrong way of looking at the data. You look at people who are doing STEM research and see what is the distribution across that. So you'll be able to see that the numbers would vary. Now, what is the research within this area telling you? One, it says that the growing numbers is an indication of a positive sign. Disciplines with low number of women, it is important to ask why. It is also important to ask the question of why these numbers are low in certain kinds of institutions vis-a-vis other kinds of institutions, because the institutional variation is very important for us to understand. It is also important to understand who is the leader of the research group in terms of looking at the constitution of the research group that you have. All of these have an impact in terms of looking at actual numbers. It is important to also look at the presentation of the data in terms of women as a whole and also with respect to disciplines. The gender gap with respect to disciplines as well as regions are very important. And the changing pattern of the gender gaps are also very interesting and needs to be examined. Very often we think that by just looking at enrollment figures, looking at the number of girls within larger institutions of science and engineering, you think that the numbers, the girls are out there and they are present. But these numbers very often do not reflect at the faculty level. And if they reflect at the faculty level, they do not reflect at decision-making levels when the faculty, when you move up in your career. And it's important to ask why this is happening. This also has a pattern with respect to specific institutions that have been old, prestigious, and institutions that have been relatively new. The patterns of gender distribution in leadership also changes with respect to your discipline being new and old. And one of the possible reasons could be that when newer disciplines are created, then you find men and women actually entering these disciplines together, and so the rules of how that group operates has fairly an equal participation of men and women. Whereas if you look at very old institutes that have by and large lesser representation of women over 10 decades, like the Indian Institute of Science, it's very hard for you to redo it within that institute because your practices are fairly entrenched. And one of the important recommendations we gave in terms of the research that we did was that institutions need to... How these different institutions and how the different groups actually behave when you're looking in terms of the years through which... Is it fine? Okay. Through the years through which these institutions have passed through. Now, when you look at women's lower participation, you have the AISH data, I said, from 2011 that this data has been available, and I think it's a very useful data and it is there in the public domain. It is important to understand the low participation of women in science research in terms of not paying only attention to frameworks that looked at personal and societal factors, but also to look at factors beyond personal and family reasons. Because a large number of research basically say that women choose not to be in science research, families don't allow women to get into science research, and societal attitudes are responsible. I'll tell you why, if you sort of restrict your understanding of women's low participation just by these three factors, it's going to be very hard for you to change these three factors because they are difficult to change because they are in a larger space. But if you look at ways in which you can make interventions at the institutional level, it becomes easier because your space is smaller. Having said this, I do know that institutions also consist of members who are also part of society. So they bring that into the institutional space. But I think that you cannot be trying to address this question only by looking at one or more than one factors, but look at multiple factors that may help you to sort of increase their representation. So it's important to look at alternative frameworks to include formal spaces. It is also equally important to analyze women's choices critically. When a woman says that I choose not to be in science, I think it's important to ask the question, why did the women respond that way? because is it a question, because you're also talking to a very educated audience. So they will also give you the responses that is politically right. And I think you need to engage with the group to understand what are the real reasons why women are not in science. And the study that the Indian Academy of Science did, where Rohini and I collaborated, that particular study, we looked at women who had left science after a PhD. And when we asked them, there was more than about 55% of them who said that we are not in science because we did not get an opportunity to be in science. And I think it's important to look at that response more critically. One, because we have trained them, given them the highest training. And two, I think you're constantly saying that you do not have enough trained people to engage in science research. So we need to look at ways in which we can engage with those women. The other finding, which I think is also very important that came out of that study, is women are looking for ways in which to come back after a career break. This is again a very cliched response. Some women say that, yes, I want a break and I want to come back. But a large number of women who had left science said that there is no way that we can come back to science if we leave science. We need to have ways in which you help this woman to actually straddle her multiple responsibilities in terms of maybe take be engaged with work, but not at that level, or look at ways in which you can engage with research in a way that will help you to balance work as well as your family when children are growing up. The only issue they have is when children are growing up, once children are older, it is useful. It is much more easier for them to come back. In the study that we did, you had a large percentage of women, over 60%, who had very easily managed a family and a career. And when you talk to each one of these women, they had very interesting ways in which they actually looked at managing family and work. And those stories are not out for people to see. They are frustrations initially when you're actually trying to draw this balance. When children are young, it is harder. When you're actually moving away from your family, because in marriage, the girl moves into the family of the husband. So you have problems of adjustment there. But I think women have done it extremely well. And within the Indian context, women have used multiple support systems when children are growing. And they have done it extremely efficiently. I think several of the women that I personally interviewed had very interesting ways in which they have managed. And they always felt that it is there as long as the children are growing. And after that, I have the world's time and I'll be able to do things. So they are very clear in terms of looking at the silver lining rather than actually trying to say that it is very difficult for me to manage when children are younger. I think the zeal, the motivation that they have to try and stay in the career is extremely important, and I think we need to actually document that. It is also important for us to look at a systematic study of publications of both men and women. When I've talked to women, I don't have data on this. This is one of the research questions I would want to pursue as part of my research. There is a notion that a large number of women said that whenever we look at publications, we are looking at a large piece. We evaluate it so that it is fairly substantial. You also have a notion of churning out several publications through one whole set of data. There are some of the women who believe they don't want to do it. Some of them really don't know how do you do and get into the number game. And I think these are issues that women are sort of grappling with respect to publications. And it may be important for us to try and understand what is the nature of publications and why are men and women publishing same. Not that I think the publication game or the definition of how publication is defined in this country is any definition of the quality of research that each one of us are doing. But I think because we do not have anything to replace that, we still go with that whole question of the number of publications. The other two things that I want to sort of flag off is, one is the culture of higher education institutions, because when I'm talking of research groups, I'm talking of institutional cultures. There are ways in which women are made to feel welcome, made to feel that they're part of the group. There are institutions that also are perceived by women, let me not say the institutions do it, they are perceived by women in terms of being fairly hostile. I think all of this actually works in very different ways when women enter these different institutional spaces, and most of the higher education institutions and particularly science institutions do not open themselves up for actual study. And unless you make a sociological study of scientific institutions, you really don't know how this operates within the institutional space. And I think it's important that we do that both with universities and institutions. And this is not specific to science institutions. I think institutional studies in this country is extremely under-researched. And basically, most institutional study literature is anecdotal and it's your personal narrative. And that does not capture the complexity of institutions or research institutions or research universities in this country. And finally, I'd like to say that the women researchers are not a homogeneous group. Let us not even imagine that even if I talk to about 100 women, that I know the whole story. Because I think the 101st woman will have a different way in which she actually negotiates and works through her career track in ways that can be very different. I think this nuanced differences is something that research needs to capture. And in a country that is as large as ours and that is so diverse, I think people engaging with research in this area is far few. And you have no large systematic studies that basically looks at these questions. And I think it's very important that it is done. Now, awards and recognitions, I don't even want to get into the details. All of us know that the number of women is smaller. I've just put some numbers for you. But I basically would want to actually visit the question of what constitutes a person or individual getting an award, who defines those rules, who are on the committee, and how does the decision get made. So sometimes you say that when the number of women is increasing with respect to some of the prizes, some of the awards that you're talking of, you tend to say that, yes, now we have got a better base because of which women are recognized. I don't think that is one possible explanation. The other possible explanation is there's an increasing sensitivity in terms of who is part of the committee and what is defined as criteria for looking at giving awards. And many of the criteria that you have for award giving, for being part of academy members, I think most of them need to be revisited to check and see, is there a bias that does not allow women to be represented equally? Having said this, it is no contention in terms of saying women's merit. I mean, it should be given to women without merit. A large number of the women scientists whom I had interviewed told very clearly reservation is not the route we want to go, but we want to be acknowledged on our right in terms of what our capabilities are. So I think it's important to visit some of these criteria, processes through which awards are given, and see if there are ways in which we would be able to sort of correct it to be more representative to a larger number of groups, which may not necessarily be women alone. It could be also people from different caste and class groups. Now, in terms of the field insights, in terms of the research that we have done, I think one of the questions I've been trying to open up with the current set of research that I've done, the data is still getting analyzed, is what is the structure of opportunity for women researchers? It is important to see what is the structure of opportunity, because many of us say that there is opportunity out there in terms of employing women. If you don't see the number of women because you have this opportunity, it is very important for us to revisit how this opportunity is constructed, because of which women are not seen. Because I think it is the outcome that becomes a better marker in terms of a particular policy that you put in place. It is not to say that we have put opportunities, women are not accessing, it's not our problem. I think the results that you're talking of, that you want to see, is in terms of the actual numbers, in terms of outcome. So opportunity is not a very sensitive measure. I think outcome is a much more sensitive measure. So if you don't see the numbers being represented at the institution, it's important to revisit your opportunity and see if you can do something about it. What are things that facilitate and inhibit their entry into certain lines and not others? Whether it is in academic institutions, you see that the representation of women is better in universities when you compare to national institutes. Should we feel very happy about it? Yes, women are doing something. But do colleges and universities give you opportunities for research? No. Then why does only national institute which has opportunity for research, why is the representation of women lesser within those institutional spaces? It is important for us to see what facilitates and what inhibits, whether it is your recruitment processes, the processes that you're talking of, which I think yesterday they were discussing in the room. How transparent can you make your recruitment policy so that women can see very clearly whether they fit the bill? A large number of women set higher standards and very often have this concept that I haven't done enough to apply for this position. And it's very important that if that clarity is given to them, there would be many more women who would actually apply for that position. For a large number of men, you have your informal network. You will have people who said, yes, you apply, there is no issues. For women particularly, taking failures, once they apply, they don't get, that's a huge thing. It's not a big thing for a man when he applies and he doesn't get. He'll still continue to apply. I think one needs to look at ways in which these things are addressed. And for this, one needs to look at more comparative data. There is also important to make this need for historical data that lends to the critical and imaginative analysis. See, when I'm talking of historical data, the issues of lower participation of women in science or engineering is also changing with time. And so you cannot use the same set of reasons why women are not participating in science and engineering as it was with respect to the older or the younger women. In fact, I have seen a pattern in terms of the responses of women scientists, where the older women say that it was much harder for us, we were smaller in numbers, we struggled through, and the younger women have it very easy. But I think it is not only the increase in the number of women in science and engineering, but I think the new generation is also very assertive. The new generation also have a way in terms of saying, we will come on our merit and you take us on these terms. So you have people who have been among the older women scientists, you have women who were willing to give up their career while men got their jobs. Today with the younger couple, they are no longer willing for that. They would walk up and say, you take a job in a lesser institute, but make sure that I also have an equal opportunity into a research career. And again, this I think you need large scale data to see how the pattern is actually changing. Conceptualizing professional identification as career commitment, career satisfaction, and professional self-image. I think these are sociological terms, but I think extremely important in terms of how identity building is happening among the women scientists. And it is important to see what is defined as career satisfaction, what is defined as career commitment where women are concerned, and what is defined as professional self-image. This can be very different with respect to different women, but I think it's important to visit these questions to understand how women navigate and understand the sociology of women in science, which I think has certain kind of tools that the discipline of sociology will give. Now the work-life balance, how much of time do I have? See, at any point I can stop because this is ongoing research and I can always talk to you about several of the findings that I have been having. See, 3 decades of research on work and family roles is constantly dominated by the conflict theory, where negative influence on outcome at work and family are documented. So basically what has been documented to say that it is very hard to draw this balance. But I think it's important to try and see whether we can pay attention to decision-making processes when people manage conflict. So conflict arises. So in conflict, do we focus on only the negative outcomes of the conflict, or do we focus on processes through which people manage conflict and the actions individuals take, one, to avoid the conflict, and the choices they make when the conflict cannot be avoided? These are nuanced ways in which women actually respond to conflict, and one needs to understand that. Documenting and analysis of women who negotiate work-life balance is extremely necessary, and it's important to look at newer ways of capturing the nuances through which women address conflict when they have to take multiple roles. More importantly, in work-life balance, more recent work that we have been doing, I've been trying to say that, is work-life balance basically balancing family and work? Is that all that it means in terms of work-life balance? Do I have a right to leisure? Do I have right for a life beyond my family and my work? Can't that actually be part of the reconceptualization of work-life balance? I think it's very important to visit that, because for a large number of women, not having a right to leisure, not having a right beyond work and family, I think has also been one of the ways in which I think their productivity is being impacted, and it's important that one looks at that. In terms of hiring and retaining, all of us would say in science institutes, it's very objective. There is no form of discrimination, and you have, and I would claim that there could be subtle forms of discrimination. And most often when we have tried to get data about it, they always say it is confidential and we cannot share with you the data. But it is only through women who have sat through these committees and through their accounts, you get a sense of how these subtle discriminations actually operate in terms of both hiring and retaining people, and also in terms of promotional policies of institutions. You have to focus effort on the problems faced by mothers struggling to raise young families while building scholarly records for tenure. Because a large number of women have young children when they need to also be very productive. How does one sort of balance the two? And I think you have very interesting data from women who have done it. And very often I tell young women scientists, you should talk to some of the successful women who have managed, whom you think are similar in terms of what your conditions are, and see how they have done it. I think those accounts become extremely useful. It is also, you have to look at the lack of family-responsive policies for non-tenured faculty, including doctoral scholars opting out of a research career. Because I think all of our policies that you have don't address doctoral students, and many of the girls actually get married when they are doing their doctoral studies. And I think policies need to look at that. You're looking at mentoring and role models. A large part of this is being covered. I just attended two sessions on mentoring. I think the role model that women look for are standards of exceptionalism. You're looking at somebody who's done extremely well. I think you have women scientists who are doing very well. Need not be a Nobel Prize winner, need not be a member of the academy, but they're still doing good science. It's important to look at role models that are closer to where you can reach. And I think this is extremely important. It is also important to look at workplaces. The visible successful women are single women, and conflict of role models and matching aspirations. See, it's very important to see that in large forums that you see, you find single women talking of the problems of women in science. The notion that younger children have is that you cannot manage a career with the family, which is not at all true. And a large number of women who manage family and work do not have the time to go into forums and talk of their experiences. They are fairly stretched doing both of them, that they just do not have the time to go on in. And many of the younger women, when I have talked to them, they have said that we pay less attention to questions of gender statements within institutions, because one of the ways of responding is not to get into a response, and then you get a response from the men, and then you again respond. It's better to just not pay attention. And many women actually look at questions of gender when they are much older and over the peak of the career. When they are actually building their career, they have very little time to actually pay to gender questions. Then let me see what I... In terms of mentoring, when I've spoken to a large number of older women, they've always said that it's very hard to mentor younger women because of your multiple responsibilities. But I just think that creating that second line leadership is extremely important for women because it would change the entire profile of women in science within the country. And so I think taking off time for mentoring becomes very important, but they feel that they don't have the time for that. And I think that's something that has got very little attention in India. And with this forum, I felt that the discussions you all have had around mentoring is extremely useful because these may seem as very trivial questions, but these are questions to which you get multiple responses in terms of the different experiences of women and men. And that is very useful. Women are much less likely to be mentored, have less access to startup packages because in terms of negotiating your salaries, which may not be the case for Indian women in science, broadly because your salaries are fairly fixed, but even in terms of your scale, I think men negotiated better and I think women are not very good at negotiating. It is important to try and see how do you really equip women to do that. Oh, one moment. In discussing, okay. Let me close with this. The older women have more powerful stories of being marginalized than younger women. And I keep asking the question, why? And has things changed with time? Do they have relatively more time to reflect on their experiences of discrimination compared to younger scientists? Is the norm of wanting not to pay attention to gender discrimination a useful mechanism to deal with the formal science environment? These are questions that I'm still pondering on. And let me close it now and take on questions. He was just telling that it'll be useful to involve the audience. So I'll be happy to take questions from